the person who's listening to this, they listen to these podcasts, they listen to theories of everything, in large part because they're trying to understand themselves, they're interested in science, they're interested in philosophy. You're also speaking to them now with this answer to this question. Who are they? They're listening to this and they're saying, I'm doing this. I'm not aware of doing it. This is all news to me, Mike. You're saying I've been doing this my whole life and this defines me? This doesn't sound anything like me. So who are you? Who are you, Mike? And who is the person who's listening? What defines them?
Well, so a few things. So the fact that there are an incredible number of processes under the hood, it has been known for a really long time. So not only all the physiological stuff that's going on, I mean, you also don't have the experience of running your liver and your kidneys, which are very necessary for your brain function. You are also not aware of all the subconscious motivations and patterns and traits and everything else. So let's assume right now that whatever our conscious experience is, there is tons of stuff under the hood, not just the thing that I just said, but everything else that neuroscience has been studying for 100 years or more. There's lots going on under the hood, and that doesn't define you. It enables you to do certain things. It constrains you from doing certain other things that you might want to do. The hardware does not define you. I think the most important thing, and look, I think this is a really important question because I get lots of emails from people who say, I've read your papers. I understand that I understand I'm a collective intelligence of groups of cells. What do I do now? I don't know what to do anymore, right? And my answer is do whatever amazing thing you were going to do before you read that paper. Like all of this information about what's under the hood is interesting and it has all kinds of implications, but the one thing it does not do is diminish your responsibility for living the best, most meaningful life you can. It doesn't affect any of that. And one way I think about this, and there's lots of sci-fi about this, but one thing that you might remember is you seen the film Ex Machina?
Yes.
And so there's one scene there where the protagonist, he's standing in front of a mirror and he's completely freaked out because the AI is so lifelike. He's now wondering, maybe he's a robotic organism too. And so he's cutting his hand and he's looking in his eye and he's trying to figure out what he is. And so let's just dissect that for a minute. The reason he's doing this and what happens to most people, which I think is quite interesting, is that if they were to open their arm and they find a bunch of cogs and gears inside, I think most people would be super depressed because I think where most people go with this is, I've just learned something about myself, meaning I know what cogs and gears can do. They're a machine. And I just learned that I'm full of cogs and gears. Therefore, I'm not what I thought I was. And I think this is a really unfortunate way to think, because what you're saying is your experience of your whole life and all of the joys and the suffering and the personal responsibility and everything else that you've experienced, you are now willing to give all that up because you think you know something about what cogs and gears can do. I would go in the exact opposite direction and I would say, amazing. I've just discovered that cogs and gears can do this incredible thing. Like, wow. And why not? Because why do you think that proteins and, the ions and proteins and the various things in your body, those are great for true cognition. I mean, like I always knew I was full of, protein and lipids and ions and all of those things. And that was cool. I was okay with being that kind of machine, but cogs and gears, No way, right? And so I think one thing that we get from our education focused on certain kinds of materialism is that we get an idea, we get this unwarranted confidence in what we think different materials are capable of, and we believe it to such an extent. I mean, I find this amazing as a kind of an educational or a sociological thing that We imbibe that story so strongly that we're willing to then give up everything that we know about ourselves in order to stick to a story about materials. I think that's, the one thing that I think Descartes had really, really right is that the one thing you actually know is that you are an agentic being with responsibility and a mind and all these and all this potential, and whatever you learn is on the background of that. So if you find out that you are made of cogs and gears, all you should conclude is, well, great. Now I know this stuff can do it as well as proteins can. And so what I really hope that people get from this is simply the idea that pretty much no discovery about the hardware, no discovery about the biology or the physics of it should pull you away from the fundamental reality of your being, that whatever it is that you are, groups of cells, an emergent mind pulled down from Platonic space, or whichever of these things are correct, the bottom line is you are still the amazing integrated being with potential and a responsibility to do things.
So many people who dislike materialism and like the more whatever they consider to be not materialism, so it could be idealism, it could be spiritualism or whatever they want to call it, or non-dualism, or trialism instead of a dualism. In part, what they're saying is, look, I'm not material, because they denigrate the material and they view it as robotic, lifeless. But you're saying there's another route. If you are material, whatever it is you turn out to be, you can elevate that. So you can say, look, there's a dynamism to it. There's an exuberance. There's a larger than lifeness to the what I previously thought was ossifying.
Yeah, for sure. And Ian McGilchrist makes a point of this too. He says that we've underestimated matter. You know, when we talk about materialism, we have been sold and are selling still this notion of matter as lacking intelligence. And I think that we need to give up this unwarranted confidence in what we think matter can do. We are finding novel protocognitive capacities in extremely minimal systems, and they're surprising to us. They're shocking to when we find these things. And I think we are really bad at recognizing what kinds of systems can give rise to minds, and therefore being depressed because we think that we are a particular kind of system, and there's no way that system can be this majestic agentic being. It's way too early for that. This is one of the, I think, the major things, is that we have this idea that we know what different kinds of matter can do. And obviously I'm not just talking about, homogeneous blocks of material. I'm talking about specific configurations, but really minimal kinds of things can have some very surprising cognitive qualities. And so it's way too early to think that we know what's going on here.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.